You're listening to the Love Covenant Church podcast with Apostle Tommy and Prophet Angela Frederick. At Love Covenant Church, our mission is to train disciples to become leaders, forcefully advancing the kingdom of God. If you would like more information about Love Covenant Church, visit our website at lovecovenantchurch.com. Now, stay tuned for today's message.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you for blessing us with life and strength. We thank you for giving us the mind to recognize your goodness. We thank you for calling us out of darkness into your marvelous light and making us a people when we were not a people, and grafted us into your special chosen people, your nation, that we would be your planting, the planting of the Lord, so we could display your glory in this earth. We bless your name and we honor you. We thank you that you made us your church, your body, your expression in the earth. We bless you for the prophetic word that went forth, for the prophetic worship, for the service in all various locations. We thank you for giving us a people who do not mind, who do not consider it robbery to humble themselves and serve unto the Lord with their whole hearts, mind, and strength. Not to be puffed up or to be vain, but because they recognize what you did for them, recognize that you saved them, recognize that you rescued them from the flames. And so we bless you in joy and honor. We ask, Lord, that you would just put a special blessing on the ears of your people, the spiritual ears, that we may hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to us as you call us to grow to a higher level, to expand, to increase in you. We bless you and we honor you. In Yeshua's name, amen. Bless the Lord. When we say Yeshua's name, for some people who say, what? I thought we was in the church. What's that name? Just want to remind everybody that we say Yeshua's name. We're saying Jesus' name in Hebrew. And we're saying Yahweh. Yeshua means Yahweh is salvation. So when we say in Yeshua's name, you can say in Jesus' name. But when we say that, we want to remember to honor Yahweh and honor that he is our salvation through his son Christ, who did what no one else could do. He was God in the flesh, and he manifested himself for us. We working it out right there? All right, so while we're working it out, let me give you a recap. We've been in the series talking about, it's the homegrown series, and the first installment we were talking about branch out. The second one we talked about bear fruit, and then we talked about stay rooted. So, as sure as we are in the kingdom, we can liken ourselves to the unrecognized small seed that is growing into a great tree that constantly produces and reproduces for itself. We learn that others benefit from the tree's concentration on itself. It has an allegiance to its own purpose. That we measure our love for others by the standard and quality of our treatment toward ourselves. And we learned that that's not selfishness. So we talked about the mustard seed and the mustard tree and how it was a small seed and how it grew into a large tree, so large and so branched out that it would be a place where the birds can nest in that place. It would be the glory of that seed, because it went from insignificance, or seemingly to be insignificant or to have no value, to become something that would have great value. And we likened ourselves, since we are in the kingdom, we likened ourselves to that thing. And I would say even put your marriage in that place. Put your business plans in that place. Put your own personal development in that place. Where there may be times where we start out, there will be definitely times where we start out seeming insignificant. Others don't value your service. They don't value your purpose. They don't know it. A lot of times you don't know it. don't know your purpose. You don't know your place in the kingdom. But as we grow, in him, he begins to pull out all those things. And it's amazing that a whole tree with its fruit and then all the seeds with more trees and fruit are locked inside of this one small seed that you can barely identify. Each kind was designed to consider and secure its own local interests first in order to ensure its survival. I'm going to break that down. Each kind. This is still the review, but we talked about how each species of tree, of creation, whatever it is, was designed by God to secure its own local interests first. In other words, the tree is not thinking about you. The tree is thinking about itself. We are thinking about the tree because we know we can benefit from the tree, but the tree is thinking about preserving its own self, reproducing after its own kind. Each kind was designed to consider and secure its own local interests first in order to ensure its own survival. All creation, more than anything else, wants to continually survive. It doesn't want to go into extinction. It wants to make sure that it lives, that it has offspring. That's nature, that's life. And we learned in Isaiah 60, 21, that we are the planting of the Lord, that he planted us, not for ourselves. And we didn't plant ourselves. How many said, I'm going to go down and become a human, and I'm going to have this purpose and this plan, and you just decided to do that, and here you are today? No, the Lord thought about you when you couldn't think about yourself. He had a purpose and plan for you before he formed you, before he made you. He already had an idea of what you would be, what you would become, what your gifts would be, what your strengths would be, what your value would be to the rest of his creation. He already had that in his mind, and then he brought you forth so that you could become what you already are, so that you can manifest, you could bring out and show what he already had in his mind for you. We are the planting of the Lord. For what purpose? To display his beauty, his splendor, his glory in the earth. It's a foundation for us to understand what it means to grow, because you can grow a lot of different ways. You can grow in a perverted way. You can grow into something that is beastly or obscene, or you can grow into something that's beautiful, something that is the praise, that brings about praise and celebration. So growth is important, but guess what? As long as you're living, you're going to grow into something. We have to decide and really deal with how we're going to grow and what we're going to grow into. All right, so we are the planting of the Lord, so we should consider the Lord when we consider how it is we're going to grow. We also learned last week, some of y'all got to get the CD to catch up on that, but we learned that the fruit or vegetable is really the reproductive organ of the tree or the ovary of the tree. Fruit is not just made for customers and consumers, but the fruit carries within it the seed and all the stuff in the fruit that we need and that we love and that benefits us, the reason why it's there from the tree's perspective is to make sure that the seed has all the nutrients it needs so that it can bear fruit and reproduce as well. So fruit is focused on legacy and fights against extinction. It's fighting against those things that would destroy the potential of the seed. All that is why the fruit is there. It's because it's the reproductive organ of what's inside of it, carrying that seed. Another quote, just like the fruit, if we are not producing results based around the advancement of future generations, we are not producing lasting fruit. I'll say that again. Just like that fruit, if we are not producing results based around the advancement of future generations, we are not producing lasting fruit. Once again, we say fruit carries inside of it the preservation of that species. It carries inside of it the preservation of what it is. It's only concerned with protecting and advancing its own kind. It's very important to understand that. Because in the kingdom, you can be concerned about a whole lot of things, but the Lord wants us to primarily be concerned with our own kind. The advancement, the perpetuation, the furthering, the preservation of our kind, kingdom citizens. As we focus on looking into how can we advance kingdom citizens, advance our own kind, then we will find out that the world will begin to pay more attention to the kingdom because kingdom citizens are prioritizing themselves. They're prioritizing to make sure that none of them are without a job. Kingdom citizens taking care of themselves. They're making sure that none of them are begging for bread. They're making sure that if one is sick, that people come to the rescue of the kingdom citizens. They're making sure, because we'll go and give our money and resources to just random organizations who are doing random stuff in the world, not realizing a lot of times they have all kind of agendas attached to that that's not godly, while we have kingdom citizens suffering because we have not prioritized, we have not become like a nation that takes care of its own interests first. Oh, you kingdom citizen, then there's a bond and an allegiance to you because of we share the same king. We're in the same government. We're in the same kingdom. Now, the Nation of Islam does it or claims to do it. You know, the Mormons, the Masons, and the different fraternities and sororities. Oh, this you on my same sorah or same frat, brother? Then we have an allegiance. We have an allegiance above anything else because we know we've shared the same covenants. We've gone through the same rites of passage. We've made the same oaths and pledges. But yet in the kingdom, we're scattered because that's your church, it's my church, it's your denomination, it's my denomination. You black, you white, we don't understand kingdom, the kingdom mentality, the kingdom concept. Oh, you speak in the language of the kingdom. You're not just being religious. Then as I hear kingdom language come out of you, there's an allegiance, a bond that I have with you that I prioritize you above others. And I take care of you more than I would take care of others. It's not that I won't take care of the stranger, but I'll take care of them last after I take care of my own. And we'll have an abundant supply so that even the stranger will not be lacking when we prioritize the kingdom objective, kingdom agenda. So this is the concept when we talk about the fruit and the tree takes care of itself and then it blesses other people as a result. Even the oxygen that we live by is the waste product of the tree so that it can keep itself healthy. What we're breathing in, we need that oxygen. The tree is just trying to get rid of it so it can keep itself healthy. So even in that, the tree is blessing us, but it's not thinking about you. It's thinking about keeping itself healthy and removing its waste, and it just so happens to be, based on the design of the Lord, that the waste of the tree becomes a benefit to all those who need oxygen. We benefit from the tree because it's highly effective at meeting every need within itself. Others benefit when we meet every need within our own thing. Others benefit as a result of it. When there are needs, when there are things lacking, then the glory is missing and people are not drawn and attracted to the organism. So let me help you understand something. Even when I say the word attractive, I had to go back the other day when I listened. I said, I don't want them to think I'm being carnal. Because when I'm talking about being attractive, understand I'm not talking about, you know, somebody looking at you and whistling. But I'm talking about whatever is attractive. And even if we go to biology for a moment, the things that we even think are attractive in the natural, biologically, there's a reason behind it. That's the reason why a man looks at a woman's form biologically and is moved by that because his genes say, I can prosper, I can be further because she can carry my seed, she can reproduce. And all these things represent what she'll be able to do to carry what's inside of me. So if you take it off that and you just look at anything that you would call attractive, it's because you see that there is a need for it and it can benefit what you want to accomplish. So when we talk about the being attractive in the glory of the Lord, it's that we will be the attraction of the nations, where they will be attracted to us because we have something that they need. And how do they know that we have what they need unless it's working for us? How will the world know that the kingdom citizens, we have what the rest of the world needs unless what we're doing is working for us? And sometimes it can work for us, but we can be so complacent and so, you know, I like the rich brats. So everything is good and become bratty, where we give a wrong presentation of what God has done for us. In other words, we really don't have any real needs. Not really, you know, everything is good, but we make it seem like it's not good because we could be spoiled. And you know what happens? You know why we get spoiled? Because we don't use what we have. And anytime somebody has so much that they can't use what they have, they become complacent and they get spoiled and they give off a bad aroma or a bad presentation of what it is that they have. If you ever find yourself in that situation where you're dealing with a spoiled brat, what you need to do is take away so they can learn how to appreciate what they do have. And once they use what they do have enough and they find joy in what they have, then they can mature enough to where they can have more given to them. The Lord does the same thing to us. He says, what you have right now is too much. So what I'm going to do is take away. I'm not punishing you. I'm maturing you. Whenever you've been in a situation where the Lord has taken things away, and you thought it was the devil, you thought it was the enemy, whatever, say, no, I'm going to take this away so you can learn that all this stuff that I've given you, you're abusing. It's all this right here, but you're not using it. So let me, somebody prayed about that, remove the distractions of the extra stuff. So you can become more, how would I say this? I'm looking for a word. Not just appreciative, but inventive or resourceful, where you can become creative and you can actually see the glory that's in what you have. And you'll see that there's more in what you have. And you really, and a lot of times, I don't even know if we understand this, but a lot of times we're asking for him to give us stuff and we already have what we need. So we need to ask him to open our eyes so that we can see what we have and we can learn how to extract all the greatness from what we already possess. All right, where am I at? The kingdom is like the tree. We bless the whole world with the abundance and overflow of the kingdom. We even bless the heathen and the pre-saved. I'm making a distinction between the heathen and the pre-saved because the pre-saved is the ones that will eventually get saved. I'm calling the heathen the ones that will never get saved. So we're blessing the heathen and the pre-saved. It is the cycle of life, and nothing is wasted. Nothing in the kingdom is wasted. So here's some kingdom application for you. We can discover great insights regarding how the Lord thinks, how he operates, his kingdom operations, his spiritual laws, and the mind of Yahweh when we study creation alongside the scriptures. Has anyone ever wanted to know or asked the Lord, I want to know your ways. I want to know how you think. I want to know how you let this happen. How did this go on? What were you thinking when you made this decision, or you didn't respond when I was expecting for you to respond? What were you thinking? But a lot of times we read the scripture, but we need to also look at life and look at life alongside the scripture and let scripture expound and explain the things that's going on in natural life. The more real and organic our growth is, the more attractive we become. It's like you're like a magnet. The more you understand that your growth is authentic, it's not artificial, it's not fake, then you become more, it's like you're more ripe. You become the desire of everything that's out there that's looking for some substance. You become the desire. And this is why God intended it. He wanted you to be the source, the resource for the nations. Organic growth is authentic and permanent. We're going somewhere with this. Authenticity. We want our growth to be real. Now, some people say, I don't like fake. I don't like people who are fake. How many are with me on that? You just don't like fake. But what does that mean? I don't like fake. People who are sometime me, fronting. But I want to tell you this. I don't want to bust your bubble or anything, but I want to tell you that we all have some fake in us. This is why he calls us to grow. He calls us to grow because we all have being sometimey in us. We all have being moody in us. And at times we say we want to do one thing one moment, and we tell people and we make a declaration, and at times we operate outside of that and contradict our ideals. That's being fake, or that's fakeness that he wants to get rid of. He wants us to become more authentic and more transparent. So one of the things I've noticed, that one of the greatest ways to grow in authenticity is to be honest about where you are. Nobody's trying to be a superstar. We ain't trying to be a superstar. I know I'm not. Just want to be real. And I want my ideals. I want my life to match up with my ideals, but I also want to be honest enough to say that I'm not there yet. But I want to let people know that I'm confessing and professing that I am that mustard tree, even though you might still see a seed right now. I'm not going to despise small beginnings. Now, some people say stuff like that, and they get excited about that because they use it as an excuse to be carnal. You know, I'm not where I ought to be. But thank God I'm not where I used to be. Well, but the question is, are you the same as what you used to be, or are you growing? You say, I'm not where I ought to be, I'm not where I used to be. But what does that really mean, that I'm not where I used to be? If I'm really growing, then there should be a testament, there should be some kind of witness where somebody else outside of you can testify to the fact that you have changed. Right? Because if I'm the only one that thinks that I've changed, then what I've done is deceive myself into really being comfortable with being carnal. So grace to grace, you know, glory to glory, faith to faith, we should be seeing evidence of maturation in our lives. I want to talk about organic growth. When I say organic growth, growth that is not artificial, growth that is not fake, real, permanent growth is produced through intimacy, interaction, constant communication. We know in the natural, you're not going to have any offspring unless somebody has some intimacy going on. Am I right? Right? So intimacy breeds reproduction, interaction. I like what Dr. Edwin Lewis Cole said. I don't know if he's the one that coined it, but he repeated it. But he was saying, you know, communication is the key to life. Anything that you constantly communicate with, you're going to grow with. And this is what we notice, because when people get mad, what do they stop doing? They stop communicating. They make a declaration that I don't want to grow with you no more. Stop talking. You ever heard when we say, you know, we're best friends, and whenever we may not talk 5-10 years, but whenever we talk, we can pick up right where we left off, right? Well, that's what you're doing. You're not growing. You're picking up right where you left off. Because you can't grow with somebody if you're not constantly communicating, updating one another, letting people know where you are in this stage and season of your life. Some people are relating to you, the 10-year-ago you. They don't know who you are now. They knew who you were 10 years ago, and they relate to you out of that mindset, out of that view, because you haven't updated them on your growth. Oh, I changed my mind about some things. I'm not like that anymore. Oh, you know, I said that, but I see it differently now because I'm different now. So now catch up with me so we can grow together. You know, it's very important that we understand that anything, and I see my shorty, She's working with, what is it, tomatoes? She's working with that, and I'm seeing the thing grow. We tried it the first time, not so successful. But that's because constant communication. That thing needs some stuff. And it needs some sunlight. It needs the water. It needs that constant interaction, constant communication. So if you want to grow in a relationship, you want to grow in your business, you know, you want to grow in anything you want to grow in, there has to be constant interaction with that thing. I looked up fruit last time and I talked to you about the ovaries and all that. I'm not going to get into the ovaries because I know every time I say that, they're like, I don't want to talk about eating ovaries. So I'm just going to go to the next point in that, and that is the biblical meaning of fruit also means rewards and results. Rewards and results. If you go to Psalm 58, and I'm going straight in here. I'm not actually breaking down the scripture. I just pulled out some stuff so I can get to a point to break it down. In Psalm 58, 11, and he goes in and says, so that men will say, surely there is a reward for the righteous. Surely he is God who judges in the earth. But if you were to really break down that passage and you go to verse 10, you see the Lord talking about just judgment and vindication, vengeance upon the wicked. And then in the midst of him bringing judgment and bringing vengeance upon the wicked, he says, so that men will say, surely there is a reward for the righteous. Surely he is God who judges in the earth. There is a reward for every work under heaven. Every work that exists, that is a work, there is a reward that is attached to it. Here we see that the work of righteousness produces the fruit of vindication. I'm going to say that again. The work of righteousness produces the fruit of vindication. In other words, when we do the work of remaining in a right standing with the Lord, he says, vengeance is mine. The fruit, the reward of being righteous is that the Lord is your defender. You don't have to defend yourself. He will vindicate you because you, he says, that's why he said, just seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. Be righteous and I'll be the judge. I'll be the vindicator. I'll be the one who brings vengeance upon your enemies. The work of righteousness means you don't have to fight your own battles. It means that he comes in and as a reward. That's also, the reward is also called the fruit. It's the fruit of righteousness. So the more righteous you become, the more meek you become, because you don't have to worry about having to fight your own battles. You can have your power restrained and trust and know that the Lord will fight your battles for you. It's the reward. It's the fruit of righteousness. It's a good thing. Proverbs 31:16 talks about the Proverbs 31 woman. And in the midst of that, if you just highlight 16, it says, she considers a field and buys it. From her profits, she plants a vineyard. From her increase, from her profits, she plants a vineyard. Think about that for a minute when you consider the Lord. We talked about that we are his planting. We are the planting of the Lord. He considered a field. He purchased it. And from his increase, he planted a vineyard. You are not the product of the Lord's poverty, but you are the product of his increase. That's why he says, you are my glory. You display my riches. You display what I can do in the earth. But if you go down further to verse 31, it says, give her of the fruit of her hands and let her own works praise her in the gates. What did we say fruit meant? Reward. So give her of the fruit or the reward of what? Her own hands, right? One of the greatest things that I'm beginning to understand about just studying this out is that the Lord has all this stuff built into his system already. He says, your reward is in the results or the fruit of your own work. We're looking for somebody else to bring us a reward for what we've done. But he said, let her own works esteem her, praise her, bring value to her in the gates. Let her own works testify of her work. Let her be satisfied by the results of her own work. The fruit, if you plant something, you would expect that you can be satisfied by the fruit of what you planted. That you would be able to sit down and enjoy the work, the finished product of the work that you've accomplished. So that's your reward. Your reward is the fruit of your own hands. I'm going to connect that to something in just a moment. So I'm going to connect it now. Your marriage is the product or the fruit, your marriage is the product of your own work. So the quality of our marriages for the married folks, because we like to complain about what somebody else didn't do or what they should have done or whatever, but the product, the fruit of our marriage is as a result of our own work. So when we're sitting down mad, and I'm not even talking at you, I'm right with you. I'm right with you. When we're sitting down complaining about what's not right, we need to understand that a lot of that is the fruit of our own work or lack thereof. So if I want to change what my reward looks like, I need to change my work. I need to increase my labor. I need to concentrate more on something. It's not just something falling out of the sky. It's what we put effort in. And somebody else said, somebody said we have to make a decision. So we make a decision to determine the quality of our life. Ecclesiastes 5:18. Here's what I've seen. It is good and fitting for one to eat and drink and to enjoy the good of all his labor, and in which he toils under the sun all the days of his life, which God gives him, for it is his heritage. As for every man to whom God has given riches and wealth and given him power to eat of it, to receive his heritage and rejoice in his labor. This is the gift of God, for he will not dwell unduly on the days of his life, because God keeps him busy with the joy of his heart. So I said earlier that every work has a reward attached to it. So the joy itself, we talk about joy. Joy itself is the product of somebody's work. It's the reward of somebody's work. You can call out anything you want to where you say you were joyful about it. You enjoyed it. You had joy in it. And I got to tell you, somebody had to work in order for you to enjoy. So joy is connected to duty, to work, to somebody's labor. Joy itself is the reward of the work of praise. So we don't necessarily praise God for tragedy, but if you are in tragedy or crisis and you praise him within it, you will get the fruit of that praise, which is joy. So therefore, you can eat the fruit of joy in the midst of a trying time, not because that trying time produced joy, but your praise is a work and it produced the fruit of joy. So that means in whatever circumstance or scenario, you can have joy because you know how to work the work that produces joy. Joy is not only something that is not just an emotion, but it's like I said, it's a byproduct of the work. That's why it says here to enjoy the good of all his labor. We're going to keep moving. Acts chapter 2:42. Before we go there, though, matter of fact, let me switch it up. Ecclesiastes 9. Get that one real quick. All this is dealing with it's dealing with the work. Bring that scripture up for me, because I don't want to read it out of this one. I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong. Y'all ever heard that part before in the scripture? Now, notice it doesn't say at the end of that, but he that endures to the end. That's not what is where it's going. It says, the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, nor the bread to the wise, nor riches to men of understanding, nor favor to men of skill, but time and chance happen to them all. That's the part the Lord, one of the parts the Lord wanted me to just stay on for a minute and bring some clarity to. He wants us to prepare. He wants us to, if you're in the race, be the fastest you can be. Be the most fit that you can be. If you're going to in a battle, he don't want you to be weak in battle. He wants you to prepare yourself. Be strong. You know, he wants us to have wisdom, have understanding, have skill. But then he says, in the midst of all of that, I want you to understand something. You could prepare. You could go to college. You could go to prep school. You could do whatever you're going to do for whatever you're trying to do. But time and chance happen to all of us. Well, what does that mean? That means that some, where's my little piece right here? Now, I'm going to let y'all know. Don't laugh at my tree, because you should have already laughed earlier when they first brought it out. Don't laugh now while I'm starting to teach this thing. All right, time and chance happen to them all. Isn't this about to get funnier, too, because I'm trying to draw a seed right here. Lord, I'm going to leave that alone. This is what I want to do. I just want to talk about it, and I want you to imagine. That's why I had an open space there, because I didn't know what to do with it. So I want you to imagine what I'm about to say in that piece right there. Time and chance happen to them all. Some seeds don't get the same sunlight as the other ones. Some of them don't get the same, get the water that they need. Some of them don't get the same access to the airflow that they need. Time and chance happen to all. I'm linking that. Some people don't get exposure to the gospel of the kingdom. Some people are not in a family environment where they can see two people loving the Lord and blessing his name and seeing how to walk upright. Now the question is, does God intervene? Sometimes, but sometimes it's wild. Sometimes it's the wilderness. Sometimes he lets life process and just happen. Some seeds never become trees. Time and chance happen to us all. So this is why I bless the Lord. I bless him because some kind of way he got the truth to me. Now you can sit down and argue about what about the people who didn't. But I want to talk about the people who did. What about the person who grew up in a Muslim home and 12-generation Muslims and they're over there? And or what about the person that they're still on trees and doing stuff like that and they never heard? Well, the scripture talks about conscience. God has something for them, the law of conscience. If they've never heard about Christ, then they have to, he's going to judge them according to the greatest level of conscience that they've been exposed to. That's a whole different teaching. But what I'm going to talk about is we heard the message. Amen. We have been exposed to the sunlight, to the water, to the nutrients. We've been planted. Our root system goes in God. But the question is, are we going to produce much fruit? Time and chance happen to all. But then not only that, he gives us the opportunity to change times and seasons for those who didn't have access to it. For those who didn't have access to life, abundance, knowing who Christ is, he gives us the word and he says, I want you to go in and change their times and their seasons. Oh, man, I'm trying to give a visual of it where there could be people who would be in the equivalent of a drought. Well, just look at this one right here, the kingdom. And this is my example of the territory being anything that would exist would be in this territory. And the Lord has planted a kingdom, rulership, order, civilization, everything that comes along with being in the kingdom. But all of this is still uncharted territories, or it's occupied by wild beasts, by lawlessness, by godlessness, by rebellion, by darkness, by ignorance, by witchcraft, by lust, by death, by anything you could think of. But now you have the kingdom right here. But he says it starts as a seed, but what's going to happen? It's going to grow, and it's going to expand, and it's going to occupy everything that the enemy is really just squatting. He's being a squatter in God's stuff. But he said the kingdom, because right after that parable, he talks about it's like yeast and how it's going to grow. It's going to fill up. That's the nature of the kingdom, that he starts, he just plants it somewhere. And then it begins to, it's very territorial. The kingdom begins to expand and take over everything that's wild until the whole earth is filled with his glory. It happens in everything. So you, your family, how you grew up, what you know, everything that you know, that's an environment. But the Lord planted you, dropped you in the soil. Kingdom seeds. Now we're growing in the grace of the Lord. We're growing in the knowledge of the Lord. But what does he expect? He expects that we grow to the point where we outgrow the limitations of generational curses. We outgrow the limitation of peer pressure and friends in the block and the streets and what was going on there. We outgrow the club, right? So we outgrow all these different things that would keep us in bondage and not being able to grow and sprout up and become what we're supposed to become. But this is how the Lord wants to do it. Now, I go back to time and chance happened to all, because there are many who have been exposed to it. But before it can really take root, the scripture talks about that too. And he's talking about the gospel of the kingdom, but it applies that there are things that happen so that it will not produce the fruit it's supposed to produce. Y'all remember the story? What happens along the process of development? Some seed fall by what? Wayside. What happens when it's on the wayside? It could be trampled over, right? People can just walk over it and step over it. So somebody is in the beginning of their walk with the Lord, or they're trying to see what this thing is about. They're asking questions, and somebody could just dismiss their questions and feel like it's irrelevant and trample over it, and that little interest dies out and it doesn't bear any fruit. Or what's another one? Thorns. What's that? The cares, worries of this life choke out the life. So some people turn away from God because of stuff going on in the world, the cares of this world. Sometimes we train our children, we train people to have more concern about the things going on in the world, natural, temporary things, and not eternal things. So they don't have a desire for things that are long-term and permanent, only right now. Give me right now. You know, so these are things that happen. We become carnal-minded, so concerned with what's happening today, we can't think about the future, long-term, eternity, generations, legacy. All right, what's the other one? We said the wayside. We said the thorns. Huh? Well, before that, before the good ground, is there another one? Huh? Huh? The birds. When the birds come through, right? And you can see that as that demonic activity coming through, and he comes to try to snatch that word before it could take root. So as soon as you get a word from the Lord, you have somebody who just walks so close with the enemy that they are always available to be used to say the wrong thing, to really snatch up, and you believe them more than believing what God said, and then snatch up that word of promise in your life. And I would say a lot of times the enemy works through familiar spirits, or what I like to call family spirits. Those spirits that are so familiar with you, where you branch out, you want to do something different, and your family wants to hold you back into what is familiar. So that's why he told Abram, I want you to start a new family, but a family based on faith and not just based on this old, this rut, this stuff that we have been in. You try to branch out, do more, be more, and they want to remind you of everything that you used to be. You know them family spirits I'm talking about. I'm going to branch out. I'm going to go to a new church where they're preaching the word. They're teaching. It's not vain tradition. It's fresh. You know, you need to come back home. That's not how we raised you. But then, this is the one we was waiting on. What's the other one? The good ground. That's the rich soil. That's the soil that has been prepared. That's the one that it's been conditioned. There's been work way before the seed was planted. There's already work being done to get that seed ready to go into that ground, producing much fruit, much fruit. So we have to understand that the same way that happens in the natural, it's happening in the kingdom. You want to know why some people, the scripture says that it rains on the just and the unjust. But you want to understand why certain people never come into the kingdom. It's because, not just because of their exposure all the time, sometimes it's their exposure, but they can choose to say, even though I hear you, I'm not feeling that. I want to do what I want to do. What does the Lord do? He does not. Now, help me out with this. I got to make sure I break this down. The Lord saw this and knew this decision would be made before he formed them. Yet he does not allow his foreknowledge to keep him from giving them an opportunity to receive him. So though he knew, he does not let his foreknowledge cause him to influence the choice. And the people were thinking they were drunk. What's going on? You know, and they begin to, Peter begins to rise up and preach and declare Christ, teaching the word. And then later on, it breaks down the culture of the church after more than 3,000 came in and were added into the church. This is what the scripture says about how the church functioned, the early church. It says they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common. 45, and they sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continually, daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. We have a culture, we have an environment that was built around. It said they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. Now, I heard some church people say, we on truth, we not on doctrine. Don't ever say that again. Because let me tell you, doctrine just means teaching. So when you say, I'm on truth, I'm not on teaching, that's ignorant. We on truth, we not on doctrine. No, we not on false doctrine, but we on some doctrine, because all doctrine is a teaching. So they remain steadfastly in the apostles' teaching, in the teaching of the apostles. What was the teaching of the apostles? The gospel of the kingdom. Because that was the teaching that they received from Christ. That was the teaching that they perpetuated. That's why you have Peter saying, hey, we're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. We're a special people. They began to, they taught people, they were colonizing them and teaching them how to be kingdom citizens. As a result of that, they begin to start hanging out, fellowshipping together, breaking bread, praying together, living among one another. But also what happened? The resources that used to go to the synagogue got shifted. Why? Because every tree is trying to make sure it stays alive itself. So if we got the church going on, and you got the Sanhedrin, and you have the Pharisees and Sadducees and temple worship going on, but now we got a new thing that has been planted. So now, it's not that they never did bring any kind of funds into the temple, but now they were changing their emphasis, changing their devotion, their allegiance. And what goes along with your devotion and allegiance? Your money. So then they begin to start bringing their money, not just to the temple, but they laid it at the feet of the apostles, because now they were identifying that this is the new movement that I'm in. I'm going to go back to this other point. I'm almost done. But I'm going to go back to this other point. We talked about communication. Whatever you constantly communicate with, that's where it's live. That's what's living, right? But we don't just communicate verbally. We don't just communicate with our mouth. We communicate with our resources. So that's why you can tell when people are going through some stuff and they start fading off, because they stop talking to you, and then they stop bringing their resources to the storehouse, to the place where they're supposed to be connected to, and it's a sign that some death in the relationship has occurred. It's a sign that there's some dying going on. Because when people are vibrant, I'm going to tell you, when I first came back to the Lord, I'm telling you what, every time Apostle opened up the altar, I was at the altar. I'm walking down the street, Curtis Wood, reading my Bible. I'm eating it up like I don't know what. I'm just eating the Bible. I'm listening to my tapes and my tape Walkman, listening to these teachings. The boring teachings, they're boring teachings, because when I know that they're boring now, because when I tried to let the Watchmen and other people listen to them when we would go on our trips, they didn't want to listen to those teachings. But it was old white men teachings, Edwin Lewis Cole, and, you know, it was some other folks. I'm just listening. Anything that my parents had that was up in the library, I'm just filled up with the word. I'm filled up. If I have something, I'm wanting to give it. I'm riding down the street. I'm seeing people walking by. It's my responsibility to stop and tell them about the Lord. Why? Because I'm full of the fact that, you know, I'm coming straight out. When I came home with some baggy jeans, a leather coat with no shirt on. Glad to be back in the house. I hate peas. But if they would have made peas, I would have ate those peas with gladness. Because whenever you're in a place, and I love that place. I love that place of starting over. And you realizing you're so grateful that the Lord didn't take you out when you were, whether it was the streets or whatever. It doesn't have to be the streets. That's, you know, some people's testimony of whether you was just blind to the fact that he's good. But when you come to the realization that the Lord has preserved me and kept me, and he still has something for me to do in the kingdom, you get so radical, and you like, I don't care what nobody say, I'm doing this thing for the Lord. I'm bringing my money, I'm bringing my praise, I'm bringing all of that. But see, the cycles, what happens is sometimes we begin to forget, just because we're living long enough, and we begin to forget. And that's why it's good to have fresh blood come in, because the younger or those who are novices or those who are fresh come in and remind us, some of us who get kind of old and stale for a minute, and remind us how good our God is. And they look at us and say, what's going on? You know, Jesus is Lord. What's going on? What's wrong with y'all? And it's good, because that's a cycle, because in cycles we have different seasons of life, and certain things we begin to become burdened with the concerns of life. And it's good to have that fresh new birth, that rebirth. That's why we need to evangelize. That's why we need to bring people in, because they will bring the new life that energizes all of us and reminds us of how good the Lord is. Calling in. That's why we call in. That's why in every prayer I hear Deaconess calling in
for the unsaved, the pre-saved come in, the backslider, the return, because there's a refreshing that takes place. And then we remind ourselves how good the Lord is. Okay, I have 5 minutes and I'm going to be out of here. I just want to talk about five things real quick, five things that will help us to branch out, bear fruit, and stay rooted. First thing, I just talked about it, stay planted. Stay planted in good ground. Stay planted in good ground. It's important for us to stay planted. What does it mean to be planted? It means for us to stay in fellowship with one another. And when we do communicate, let's talk about kingdom things. Let's build on something that's eternal. Let's talk about Christ and who he is and his goodness. Let's testify of who he is. Let's communicate to one another spiritually so that we can be edified and built up. Let us not forget the doctrine of the apostles' doctrine. Let's not forget the teachings of those who founded this place that we've been assembled in. Let's not forget those teachings. I mentioned the Walkman because I don't know how many people go back and listen to CDs that were already done anymore and replay them over and over. If you listen, and most people, you only hear the message one time when it's being delivered. But if you ever would just go back and just take about five CDs and just keep listening to those things over and over, you keep hearing the Lord speak and bring out other stuff that you missed over and over, and it gets in your spirit, and then you begin to start walking that thing out. I've noticed a lot of times it's some things, we talk about work, but it's some things I don't have to do. I just let the word work in me, and the word does it, and I realize I was changed without my own effort. Not that it doesn't take effort, but my effort was in prioritizing the word of God, and the word began to change me before I even had an opportunity to think I need to change, because I was filled with the word. So stay planted, stay rooted, keep filling yourself up with the knowledge of the word, with the music that has the word in it, prophetic music, music that speaks, not dead music now, but that music that has life in it. Fill yourself up with an environment of the kingdom, all right? The second thing, keep producing. Keep producing. Stay active. Stay working. Stay diligent in your purpose. Stay active. Stay working. That you're not going to really grow if you're not working. Because, see, there's something that comes out of that. There's something that comes out of working for the Lord. Now, those of us who work for the Lord, we have conversations like it's not all about work, but it's about relationship. But what we got to understand is some people haven't even got to that place yet. Some people need to understand what it means to do the work for the Lord, to bring their talents and their abilities and to offer them up to the Lord and see that he's satisfied or that he accepts our offerings as something that's good. That helps us to grow. If you're in the kingdom, you should be working in the kingdom, doing something, producing for the Lord in some kind of way. And when you do it with gladness. Do it with gladness. Also, protect your seed. That's the watchman part coming out right there. You got to protect your seed. So we still have to have a gatekeeper, watchman mentality over the things of God and over the things of the kingdom. We can't be just so free, and I'm all about being free. I don't like being controlled by people. Let me just go on this sidebar real quick. I don't like being controlled by people. I don't like people trying to tell me you got to do it like this, whatever. I like being free. But in all of your freedom, we have to have self-restraint. We have to be governed. We have to have self-control. We got to walk by the Spirit, not by the flesh. And in all of that, we got to be watchmen and look out for anytime you're trying to be free and go out into the wilderness, you're going to run up across those wild beasts in the wilderness. And I found myself trying to be free sometimes and ended up finding some wild beasts in the wilderness that really challenged my faith. Then you go back and like, okay, I'm not ready for that right there. I need to get back where I need to be. Yeah, they say the way they say it is real nice and sweet. Be free till you're fool. That's what happens. We get free till we're fool, and then we find ourselves in foolishness. All right. So protect your seed. So the first one, stay planted, keep producing, protect your seed. Be a watchman. Look out for. There's still spirits and demons out there, you know. Even though we hadn't talked about it for a while, you hadn't seen a whole lot of deliverance sessions, it's still demons out there. There are lying spirits out there. There are spirits of witchcraft and idolatry out there. It's still all kind of stuff going out there. But, you know, and we have a good immune system if we're in the Word, but you need to know that that's out there, all right? Populate your territory. Populate, what do I mean? Fill every space with Christ-likeness. Fill it up. Fill it up. Fill every space with Christ-likeness. Reproduce. Recruit. How many people still recruiting? Recruit. Tell some people about what the Lord is doing, and not only what the Lord is doing, what he's doing in here. Why? Because we can't be responsible for somebody else's upbringing under another leader or whatever. All we can know is if you're close to me, we'll make sure you stay straight. So I'm going to tell you about what God is doing at LCC, because in LCC, I can tell you if somebody did something wrong or something, I can talk to that person about that. If somebody mistreated you, I can deal with that. But just telling them about Jesus without telling them about where you are and where you fellowship, where you worship, that's halfway. That's not complete. That's not a complete work. We need to tell people about the Lord, tell them about the kingdom, but also tell them about our local assembly and what God is doing here and why they need to stay close to us so we can help monitor their growth and help them become all that God wants them to be. All right? Provide in all seasons. If you go to Revelations 22, 1 through 2, it talks about a tree, if we can get to that scripture. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. And in the middle of its street and on either side of the river was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. So we're talking about a tree that never is barren. We're talking about a tree. That's why Christ was so angry with the fig tree. You're producing leaves and stuff like that, advertising like you have fruit, but you don't. But he said, he wants us to be. This is what and he was really showing a picture of Israel. But what he wants us to be is a tree that in every season we can bear fruit, and that we would have leaves that would be the healing of the nations. In other words, at any moment, at any time, people can come to us and live and not die. By your influence, by your preparation, by the fruit of the Spirit, by the gifts of the Spirit, by the work of your hands, by the praise, by everything that we do, by the culture of the kingdom that we live in, when people come and eat from us, they'll live and not die. It will be for the healing of the nations. That's his desire for us, that we would branch out, bear fruit, and stay rooted. Amen.